And in fact, he's never run for any other office, possibly because he knew that. But his victory 5 months after a very similar coalition of people in terms of color and class and ideas brought Britain out of the European Union does suggest that something is up. You know, one event like that could be a fluke. 2 in 5 months makes you think there may be a trend here. And when you analyze what happened in Britain in the spring, who voted to leave? How many of them admitted to the pollsters beforehand that they did plan to vote to leave? And that was a very significantly smaller number. Just like the United States, that sort of hidden 4% who were going to vote for Brexit or for Trump, but never told the pollsters. And so we get surprised on the night. They are the same, how shall we put it, socioeconomic ethnic group. They are people who are living in the Rust Belt, so the respective countries, the northeast of Britain and parts of Wales and northwestern England, some of the Midlands as well, and the Rust Belt of America. From, you know, if you look at the key states that Trump won, they were the Rust Belt states. They were Michigan and Ohio, where the jobs have vanished, and where the old white working class feels defeated and destroyed. Same group in both countries. Same appeals being made to anti-immigrant sentiment, racism, and the same idea that what we need is a radical guy who will change the terms of trade, who will get us back on track to the kind of glory days of the 1980s when everybody worked and the unions were strong and, you know, they'll rebuild Cleveland and Buffalo and Detroit and all the rest of it. It has appeal. And the truth of the matter is that the old white working class has been horrendously neglected, particularly in the United States, but in Britain as well, and to a very limited extent in Canada, because in fact we don't have a Rust Belt. I mean, we have a very different system, and we have benefited enormously from NAFTA. Without NAFTA, I think we might have a Rust Belt in Ontario. But we managed to keep all the car plants. They went south to Mexico from the United States, but they didn't. The distribution remained between Canada and the U.S. remained the same. This group of people who feel marginalized, ignored, defeated, and are looking for somebody to blame, and they're looking for a savior. And there is a constant supply of potential populists. Every political niche is always filled. They're always there. But given enough, you know, sort of fertilizer and water, they will grow and flourish. And they got the fertilizer and the irrigation in the context of what's happened to the old white working class. There are other people who voted for Trump, of course. I mean, there's some flat-out racists, even if they're prosperous. There's a larger group who are functionally racist, but whose dislike of immigration is fueled by a sense that their country is losing the identity it had when they were kids, and of course it is. And you'd be okay with that if you were flourishing yourself, but not when you're not flourishing. And so there is this incoherent cry of rage, really. I mean, if you think about it, both in the UK and in the US, the people who voted for Brexit or for Trump were actually doing themselves, this was a serious act of self-harm. I mean, outside the European Union, Britain is definitely not going to be more prosperous. It's going to be a great deal less prosperous in all likelihood, because the European Union is not going to give them going away presents. And Mr. Trump, if he carries out all of his promises, is probably going to destroy America's foreign trade and create even more lost jobs. he'll also quite possibly get the United States involved in wars. There's a, we'll talk about what he may do in detail. And of course, Canada will be collateral damage in the trade wars, at least. But there is a problem here, which is in a large section of our society that was once regarded as central and, you know, the white working class. Well, 50 years ago, whites were 95% of the population in Canada and 85% of the population in America, so it was the working class. You don't have to give it a color at that point. Have been abandoned. Even the cities they live in have been abandoned in the States. And they put up with it for a long time, really, and were put off with promises and voted for people who didn't look after them. And you know what Boris Johnson did in London, in England, or what Donald Trump has done in the United States is finally to identify exactly what would mobilize these people and make them a powerful political force. I'm surprised it didn't happen before. And frankly, it is now a phenomenon throughout the West. There are elections due in France and in Italy and in the Netherlands in the next 6 or 8 months, all of which contain the possibility for a Trump-like movement coming to power. Front National in France, Marine Le Pen, she's running 40% in the polls now, neo-fascist. The Five Star Movement, Beppo Grillo in Italy, and the various extreme anti-immigrant movement parties in Netherlands, all doing very well in the polls. And the driving force is the same. It comes out as anti-immigration, it comes out as anti-globalization, because the understanding of the people who suffered is that somehow our jobs were sent abroad, or the immigrants stole them. But it's really about the destruction of the old working class. And we haven't done a thing about it. And as I say, in Canada, the problem is less severe because we've got the kind of country that actually does look after its people a little bit better. And we have been sheltered by the NAFTA agreement, no doubt about it. But we have a problem here, which is right through the industrialized world. I mean, I'm waiting for to see it happen in Japan. Bound to happen there as well. I mean, Japan didn't used to have people sleeping under bridges, it does now. So, what is Mr. Trump going to do? How far will the infection spread? What is at risk? And, I guess, in the end, what do we do about it? Listen to Trump, and the first thing you've got to figure out is whether he means what he says or not, because he is all over the map. But I think there are certain things that you have to take very seriously that he says. I think all the promises he has made to destroy NAFTA, to impose a 45% tariff on all Chinese-made goods imported into the United States, and a 35% tariff on all Mexican-made goods, you know, which are actually made by American companies that relocated to these low-wage areas and use free trade to export the products back to the United States, so they're still filling the American market, but they're not paying American wages anymore. These promises are real. He's going to do that stuff. That is something he has to do in terms of fulfilling the expectations of the people who voted for him. Which poses Canada rather a large problem. About 80% of our foreign trade is with the United States, and we are more heavily dependent on foreign trade than almost any other industrialized Western country. It could get very ugly. They're trying to talk calmly in Ottawa about it, but beneath the surface they're in a flat panic. Can you use your ties with American industry and American unions to somehow buffer yourself from this? I don't know. They don't know. They're going to try. I mean, you can already see the Canadian government reopening consulates that got shut down in lots of American cities. We need American allies in Congress to, if we hope to limit the damage from what Mr. Trump's going to do. But he is going to do it. So it's going to be rough around here for a while, I think. In Mexico, it's going to be catastrophically rough. And China is really scary. China is already in very deep economic trouble. They didn't have a recession after the 2008 crash because they pumped so much money into the economy, mainly in building useless infrastructure, but it provided jobs, that they managed to keep wages and employment levels up. But it's 8 years later, and that trick is running out of steam. And the Chinese government itself admits, well, claims, that the current level of economic growth in China is around 6% a year. They've come down from 10 to 8 to saying 7 at the beginning of this year to saying 6.5. I would be astounded if it was 4%, and it may be zero. They're clearly lying. There's all sorts of indicators where they would be if there really was that level of economic growth. They're way below. Now, the problem with China, even leaving aside Mr. Trump's influence on the situation, is that the Chinese government is not intrinsically a very popular government. It is still a communist government, even if the ideology doesn't work anymore. And it's not, they don't even try to make the ideology work, but they do use the claim to power that comes with a communist philosophy. And they're not loved. They stay in power because they keep the goose laying the golden eggs. High-speed economic growth, that rising tide raises all ships. And as long as the money keeps coming in and the growth keeps coming in and people's life living standards go up, the Chinese government is tolerated, but it is not loved. And if the growth has stopped or is stopping, it's in trouble. And already there's millions of people being laid off in the Chinese steel industry, for example. Literally millions of people being laid off. Add to that an American interruption on the export trade to the United States, which is at the core of high-speed Chinese growth. A lot of this industrial growth was financed and led from abroad by American companies going offshore. If that export trade to the United States is seriously interrupted, what is already a pretty dismal economic situation will go critical in China. And I would expect at that point serious protest against the Chinese communist monopoly of power. What do they do in order to divert that anger? And the answer is they look for foreign enemies. So I can see a military confrontation growing out of the trade confrontation between the United States and China that Mr. Trump is committed to engage in. So our time's all over. And of course, there's other things that are going to happen too. Leaving aside the damage he does domestically, you know, things like ending affordable care or Obamacare, you know, 20 million more Americans losing their health insurance that they only recently got. But he's also abandoning, of course, any American support for attempts to curb global warming. The rather promising and better, as good as you could have hoped for, agreement that we got out of the Paris conference last December, he has announced that he's going to cancel. Well, he can't do that because 87 countries have already ratified it, but he can certainly pull America out and do his best to sabotage, as he will do, a global accord or the enforcement of global rules on emissions. This is very serious stuff because we are in deep trouble now. The hottest 5 years in history have all been in the last 6 years. And for the last, it's now 14 months, I believe, every month has broken the record for that month at any time in terms of average global temperature. We may be heading into runaway right now, in which case even Paris won't save us. But assuming that it is perhaps just a statistical deviation that we'll drop back, we still don't have a lot of time, and we're going to lose a lot of it, just like we did with Mr. Bush. We're going to lose a lot of time that we know we can't afford to spare on climate change. And he is going to make a deal with the Russians, almost certainly, that will finally destroy Islamic State, but it will also put Assad back in power in all of Syria. I'm ambivalent about that, because without some solution, brutal solution like that, the war could go on there as long as the Lebanese Civil War went on next door, and that was 15 years. So I don't regard that as an unmitigated disaster. But he is a bull in a china shop, and it's a rather packed china shop. So we have some serious problems coming up, including Canada. From our perspective, especially Canada. But I want to challenge the assumption that this is really about globalization and immigration taking the jobs. Because I don't think that's what's taking the jobs. In the 80s, when you started getting the first real globalization, the first global free trade deals, and, you know, became possible to offshore stuff, to move abroad, manufacture stuff, export it back to your home country, you know, at, you know, larger profits, far lower wages where you move to. Then definitely jobs were being shipped out. Although I would say, by the way, that half the jobs in the Rust Belt that did get shipped out got shipped south to the southern states of the United States, the Sun Belt. They didn't go to Mexico. They didn't go to, I mean, they fixed that in Cleveland, but actually they're now in Alabama. But increasingly, as time has gone on, the jobs are not being exported. That's not the principal source of the loss of jobs. Nor is immigration. Any study I have seen suggests that immigration has nowhere created a shortage of jobs. First jobs immigrants get generally are jobs nobody else wants. And as they move up the food chain, the economy is expanding with them, and there's no evidence that employment rates in Canada, for example, have responded negatively to very high, by world standards, rates of Canadian immigration. We're right up on the top rank in terms of the proportion of our population we take in as immigrants, and I can see no damage. In fact, all the places that are thriving economically in Canada is the places where there's lots of immigrants. Pleased to see the Saskatchewan is, in the least of the cities, doing its bit. But I don't think it's the jobs going abroad. And I don't think it's the immigrants stealing the jobs. I think something else is going on here. And until we address that, I don't think we have a hope of dealing with the kind of phenomena that put Mr. Trump in power. The jobs are evaporating because automation is eating them. That's what's really happening. Didn't even get mentioned in either the Brexit referendum public discussion or the American election campaign recently finished. But look at the numbers. American manufacturing in 1979, I can't remember the numbers, so we'll say X trillion dollars of product in 1979. It did the same survey in 2014, and in constant dollar terms, allowing for inflation, American industrial production in 2014 was 2x. It's doubled. America is still the second largest manufacturing country on the planet. And since a great deal of the production in China is going to feed a population 4x as large, in terms of high-end industrial production, it's probably still the largest on the planet. What's disappeared is the jobs that produce that larger industrial output, because they're not required. The, you know, we began by losing the easily automated jobs on assembly lines, repetitive, relatively simple. Then we started losing the jobs like bank tellers, a lot more sophisticated, you know, three or four complicated operations being carried out, money in, money out, moving money between accounts, got to recognize the customer, make sure she is the person she says she is. All of that is now done by the machine in the wall. Mind you, doesn't recognize you as a person by your face, but the magnetic strip on your card will do it just as well. And so every ATM is the ghost of three bank tellers, as they say. And as the algorithms get more sophisticated and the programs grow bigger and smarter, and you can start now calling it artificial intelligence, AI, it's moving into, for example, the various support functions in the legal profession and the medical profession, initial diagnosis, conveyancing, things like that. Jobs are disappearing there. You can have a university degree and lose your job to automation. Just depends what you do. Sorry, did I upset anybody here? And a study was done in the United States, but by a couple of Oxford economists, actually, very respected ones. They did a study in 2013, and what they did was they tried to figure out what proportion of American jobs were vulnerable to being destroyed by automation in the coming 20 years, counting from 2013. And they did it trade by trade. I mean, this was a fine-grained analysis of when do these jobs become vulnerable. They're too sophisticated, you require too much more flexibility to automate them now, but, Moore's law, computing capacity doubles every 2 years, still true, and so when will it reach the point where these jobs can be done more cheaply by machines? And the number they came up with was 47% of existing American jobs are vulnerable to replacement by AI in the next 20 years. What we have here is a phenomenon comparable in its implications to the first industrial revolution. The jobs are not coming back. We're not becoming poor. This is not necessarily a disaster. The machines are producing what we used to produce, and presumably the point of producing things was because we needed them, and they're still there. And they will continue to be there. The problem is only, how do you deal with both the spare time and the lack of money of the people who are not required to do that production anymore? How do you keep them fully integrated members of society who can raise their families, support themselves, have a real life, and not feel marginalized, cast aside, neglected, humiliated? That's the task. I mean, I think that is the political task for the next generation at least. The change is going to be big. It won't be in terms of moving people, let's say, from farms to cities, as big as the Industrial Revolution was the first time, but in terms of changing the way people work and spend their days, it will be just as big as uprooting the farmers of England in the 1780s and making the working classes of Manchester by 1850. That big. And so we've got to figure out how we cope with a society, a very rich society, that can support all of its members but doesn't require the labor of all of its members. That's the task to come. And there's already people nibbling at the edges of this problem. I don't know if you noticed, you didn't get much coverage over here, I think. The Swiss had a referendum early this year on a guaranteed national income, which is an attempt to address exactly this problem. I mean, they say, in Switzerland, you can get a subject on the ballot for a referendum if you can get 100,000 people to sign it. And there's, 8 million Swiss, so they got the numbers and they put it on the ballot. Obviously, too early for a guaranteed national income to be accepted by the bulk of the population. Well, they're not working, why should they have any money? And so the referendum result was no. But you can see people are thinking, how do we deal with this problem? We've got enough money, everybody should have a share. I'm not talking communism here, but I am talking, you know, fair's fair. We don't need everybody to work, but you've been here all along, and you are entitled to, you know, to share the benefits of what we've accomplished here collectively. And no, there will still be 53% of jobs in 20 years' time that will require actual human input, and that's fine, and you can top up your income if you can get one of those jobs, but you probably won't keep it all the time. That's one approach. There are others. I just mentioned that one because it's actually got out into daylight already. But that's, I think, what we're going to have to do. It's not the worst task you could be set, how to distribute abundance fairly. But, of course, in the meantime, we've got to get through the shitstorm that Mr. Trump is going to drop on us. So there you go. Life as usual. Thank you very much. Comments, and of course, Mike's in the aisles.
Thanks again for coming. I appreciate ending on how do we fix this. How do you convince people that just voted for Trump that a universal basic income is probably in their best interest and will probably be needed to be funded by some sort of wealth tax? When?
How do you persuade people? Damn if I know. I mean, a lot of people tried, didn't they? And they didn't make much progress. I think before the people who voted for Trump will listen to you, they have to be feeling a lot better about themselves. So that's the end you've got to address. I mean, you notice one of the things Trump said, he's not stupid, you know, or at least he's selectively stupid, about rebuilding infrastructure. You know what he's talking about. He is going to go and reward his voters in the Rust Belt states by rebuilding, you know, Cleveland and Buffalo and Detroit. And God bless him, he should. You know, we owe those people something. And once they can see that somebody is addressing their issues, they will actually be able to hear you talk when you talk. But they can't at the moment. They're going la 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 la. They don't want to hear that stuff. They want to hear somebody say, we're going to kick over all the existing systems and punish everybody who's neglected you for so long. You know, a lot of people, frankly, understand that Trump is a loose cannon, and they voted for him anyway because they just don't care anymore about consequences. They're so fed up, they're so angry, and you got to address that before you can get them to listen. Yes, please.
So you talked about terrorism not being as big a problem as we thought. I could buy that argument. The problem with it is the amount of displacement that's been caused by the refugees and the people overflowing into Europe and other countries in terms of the destabilization of those countries, cultures, and their ability to accommodate people in a way that they can get meaningful employment, live lives, integrate into society. So, I mean, it's just a comment. And so a small problem has created a much bigger problem.
Yeah.
And we have to figure out how to solve that. So that's just a comment. I don't know if you want to comment on that. But I do have a question.
Good. Absolutely.
You did not comment on the African wing of the Al-Qaeda-influenced terrorists.
No.
Could you talk about that? Thank you.
Okay. The African wing is mostly in North Africa, but it is also in northern Nigeria. So we've got Boko Haram, very nasty group in northern Nigeria, now in retreat. The Nigerian army, which is hopelessly corrupt, and in fact some people in it were actually selling both arms and intelligence to Boko Haram, but the new president, not that new now, has taken somewhat more robust attitude, approach to corruption in the Nigerian army. And they've driven Boko Haram back. In East Africa, Al-Shabaab in Somalia is still on the loose. The African Union sent troops there to try to contain it, and some of them are going home because they're fed up. The Ethiopians have just pulled out. People keep talking about putting Somalia back on the road to being a proper state rather than a failed state. They haven't covered the first 100 yards yet. And there are lesser Islamist movements. I mean, I'm assuming, I'm not talking about Arab North Africa, we've already dealt with that. But it really hasn't penetrated that far. And frankly, whatever happens in Somalia, I'm going to be brutal. Apart from maybe Kenya and Ethiopia, nobody cares. Because it's really not going to upset a lot of apple carts, you know? We've lived with it for 25 years already. Somalia became a failed state in 1991. And yeah, they hijack planes out in the tankers in the middle of the Indian Ocean, and there's refugees all over northern Kenya, and all sorts of bad things happen to good people. But it's a very local problem. It barely joins up with the Arab world. So that sort of that African phenomenon is, you know, it follows in the wake of what's been happening in the Arab world, because in fact, to the extent that Africa, the northern half of Africa, is a large Muslim population, they all got it through the Arabs. It was Arab missionaries, it was Arab scholars who brought Islam to West Africa and to the Horn of Africa. So they do obviously, you know, get a lot of backwash from anything that happens in the Arab world. Not so much for northern Nigeria, but even there, really. But it's not independently, leaving aside what's happening in the Arab world, if you just look to that in its own right, it's not a very big deal. Except in Somalia, and Somalia itself is not a very big deal. Yes. Oh, sorry, there is someone on this side now. Forgive me. Yes, please.
First of all, I wish to commend you on your presentation.
Thank you.
And that you have very much become a Canadian institution. Because all the Americans... Because while the Americans may have known Chomsky, I don't think he can list in laughter his presentations.
Well, thank you.
Okay. Then secondly, there is just an observation.
Yes.
During the 1960s, I met a priest who had raised 3 generations of school children in Zimbabwe of the Community of the Resurrection. He told me that the Shona people are unable to fight. They're such a weak and pleasant people, and he had seen them. This was when Robert Mugabe was beginning to enter the frame, and Joshua Mugabe was still And so things, as you present them, the status quo as it exists now is largely an Arab manifestation of a problem called terrorism. But terrorism has manifested itself in all kinds of ways throughout the years, where people want to overthrow, change, and largely the leadership. Society is divided, distinctly in 3 parts. We have the very rich who are afraid of losing their money. We have the very poor who are wondering where the next meal is coming from. And then we have the little bit, what more, what we used to call in Marxist-Leninist terms, the aspiring petty bourgeoisie. And these, by and large, from every tribe and country, these were the people, men or women, providing the leadership. And so therefore, we look for leadership among the class who would provide, out of the Trump, out of everything, all the difficulties that humanity faces itself at the moment that we would miss. But thank you very much. Do continue.
Yeah.
Around mid-October, the National Post ran a story that was trying to rewrite the events of the shooting on Parliament Hill. And I wonder if you think that was because they're showing a sincere interest in post-traumatic stress and RCMP officers involved, or whether they're just trying to inflate the problem again.
I think the latter. I don't make fun of post-traumatic stress. It's really serious. But you know, guys who go through a year or so of war get post-traumatic stress. I know occasionally an individual can get post-traumatic stress from one horrible incident too, but this is not a big deal, honestly. You know, we don't have people committing suicide because of things like this. And yes, I think it's manipulation. Yes.
First of all, I'm not a Trump fan at all, right? But I just want to ask, isn't the U.S. Congress in a position to maybe rein in Trump somewhat? Or can you comment on that? Like, I'm not sure how much
he... First of all, the Republicans managed to hold the Senate so they control both houses of Congress. Obviously, a great many American Republicans, including congressmen and senators, regard Trump as a loose cannon. But it is very hard for Congress to deny Trump a lot of what he wants, because he does have the tickets in terms of having won an election on the platform. It's not new stuff he's bringing. Their situation will be very similar to the majority of people in the British Parliament who hate the idea of Brexit. But they're forced to go along with it and try to moderate it at the edges and, you know, can we manage to keep a free trade deal with Europe and so on, because they cannot come out and say, no, this is nonsense. It is nonsense, but they can't do that, especially because they're mostly conservatives, and the conservative government gets their support, whatever it does, you know, whatever the American hero was who said, my country, right or wrong, John. Never mind, but you know what I mean. My party, right or wrong, and I don't think that the Congress will be a major restraining influence at all. I mean, Congress, and particularly the Republicans in Congress, of course, are very closely aligned with big money in the United States, big industry, big banks, things like that. Who are going to be panicking as Trump unfolds a little Christmas box, but even they are going to find it, until Trump loses some of the shine he has with his current support, until he fails publicly at a couple of big things, he's virtually bulletproof, certainly in terms of a Republican-dominated Congress, he's not going to have much problem. They're not going to lie down on the road in front of him, he'll run right over them. Yeah.
Given the new administration in the States, I'm just wondering what you think the future holds for the various military treaty organizations that the U.S. is central to, NATO, NORAD, their agreement with South Korea and Japan, and what do you think is likely to overshadow it with the Russians, or will something like that occur?
Yeah. Well, I think NORAD is sufficiently harmless that it's safe. I mean, it doesn't take a lot of money anymore. There ain't, you know, there's no bombers coming over the pole, and so what remains of it will probably survive. The Air Force is good at defending its corner, U.S. Air Force. NATO is a much bigger problem because, of course, Trump has been saying we're giving all the other NATO countries a free ride, and if they don't stump up 2% of their national budgets and pay us for our contribution in terms of troops abroad and bases and so on, we're going home. And there goes an alliance that is now 48 to 2016, 68 years old. And it has, for all of its flaws, actually held Europe together in peace. And I give the European Union full credit, but certainly in the early days it was essential to keeping Europe together. Is it required to stop the Russians from conquering Europe? Obviously not. The Russians have no intention of conquering Europe. Is it a safety comfort for Estonians and Ukrainians and so on. Yes, of course it is. All the Ukrainians aren't and never will be in it, but the Baltic states are and the Poles are. And given the history, they're a bit paranoid about the Russians. I don't think the Russians even want to take Estonia back, but the Estonians do, and it makes them feel a lot better to have NATO. So a little bit of damage there. But in a way, NATO is an alliance that has sort of outlived its purpose. The Russians, you have to remember, Russia is not a great power like the old Soviet Union was. It's got half the population of the old Soviet Union. It's substantially deindustrialized. Apart from the defense industry, it is not in leading-edge technology much. And the main source of income of the Russian government is oil and gas exports, not taxes. So we're not dealing with the Soviet Union. They couldn't hold up their end of a Cold War if we had another one. So, you know, how much do we need NATO? And the answer is it makes people in Eastern Europe feel comfortable. And apart from that, I'm not sure, really. So, you know, if he does go after NATO in a big way, I think he will be satisfied with little increases in defense expenditure here and there that make it look like he won. I don't think he'll actually tear down that temple, but if he does, well, I will probably survive. Yes, sir. Oh, well, wait, yes.
I have a bunch of things. I'm having trouble remembering.
We are running out of time, so try one of them.
Okay, yeah. The U.S. unemployment rate is 4.5% right now, and ours is 7.2. The city of Calgary, where I come from recently, is over 10%.
Yeah.
It seems to fly in the face of what you're saying about technology being a big driver, automation, but you're not the first person that said that, so maybe you can comment on that. And I also find it amazing that the U.S., I was most recently in the job market, and the U.S. is not hiring Canadians. I don't know why. I was guessing maybe it was because Trump was threatening to cancel NAFTA. If he did that, every person in the U.S. that's Canadian working on their TN visa would have to come home immediately. So anyway, those are the most important things. Thanks.
Oh, no, it gets really rough. But the unemployment, there's a thing about unemployment figures you need to understand. Somebody did work on this in the United States quite recently. U.S. unemployment level nationally is around 6%. That's official unemployment, which is counting people who are actively seeking jobs. If you want to know how many males, particularly males, I mean, it's true of females too, but to a lesser extent, how many males of working age, 20 to 65, are not working in the United States, the number is almost three times as big. It's up around 16-17%, higher than it's ever been in history. I mean, you can call them discouraged people, discouraged workers, you have various phrases used for them, but there's an enormous underground unemployment, what we used to call unemployment problem, already. And a lot of that is, in fact, jobs that just vanished. And it's a growing proportion of the, in the 80s, jobs really were going overseas, and automation wasn't eating jobs. But the balance has shifted over the decades, and now I would say the biggest problem by far is automation, and going forward into the next two or three decades, more and more so. So that's really the long-term problem I think we have to solve. Are we right on it? We've got two people left. Fast and quick and dirty, and then we're out of here. Yes, please.
In both cases, in terrorism as well as Trump, you indicated media as being one of the key players. In general, when you see currently ethics, when it comes to ethics, not just among media, even higher institutions, the level of ethical reporting has gone down.
I agree.
And because of that, there is a lot of misinformation that's going, and people don't get the right information. If they don't get information, that's why Trump managed to get away with all these kind of things he says, and it's not being reported. The reports that come out are either the media is scared of corporations who pay for you know, advertisement money. That's the whole thing. It's rating, rating, rating. Nothing about truth anymore. So how can we go forward and get accurate information in such distorted era where money can do anything without getting fact to the fact?
Look, you're talking about the trade I've lived my life in, and I know how bad it is. But one of the reasons it is so bad is that the business model is broken. You can't make money publishing newspapers. You can't make money running television stations even anymore. The average newsroom is down by 75% in population over the last 25 years. So the reporting that used to be done by four reporters is done by one. You mustn't expect in-depth analysis. They've got 2 hours to give you this story. And the reason the model is broken, of course, is because the advertising money has moved on the web. And I don't have a fix for that. I mean, it's affecting me in the sense that newspapers can't pay me as much as they used to. Some of them go out of business, all that sort of thing. But for people whose whole income depends on one newspaper, one radio station, it's murder. And the people who are left are run off their feet. All of the things you say are true, too. But I think the biggest problem is if there is no business model that works for the media that will allow them to put somebody on a story for 2 weeks, even if it's very important, we don't have that person. We fired him 3 years ago.
Well, we let it happen.
Well, I mean, I didn't let it happen. You didn't let it happen.
CBC, for example, should be state government and people, we all should fight for that. Otherwise, how do we get information?
Look, I agree with you, but I don't know how to fight it. I really don't. You give me a business model that will actually make the media capable of employing the people who can do the job. Believe me, I will go out there and try to sell it for you. But I haven't seen one, actually. And I wish I had. Yeah.
Thanks for coming. I remember reading quite a long time ago that there were some Islamist groups that were going into poor areas of Pakistan and Afghanistan and different countries and saying, oh, you don't have schools, we're going to provide these great schools for you, and using it as indoctrination sites. And I was wondering if that's still going on and if it's something to worry about.
It's going on in a different sort of way. Something similar is happening in Muslim communities in the West. It's in this case Saudi Arabian money building mosques and providing imams and so on. And they're not terrorists. But the version of Islam that has become the major Islamist ideology is very close to the Wahhabi version of Islam, which is followed in Saudi Arabia and which they have been exporting to immigrant communities, Muslim communities all over the planet. And though, you know, immigrant communities tend to be poor, you know, and if you were, you know, the first, I don't know what how many Muslims there are in Prince Albert, but I'm sure there weren't many 20 years ago. And so you arrive in Prince Albert and you want a mosque, but you don't have the money. Along come the Saudis and say, we'll build it for you, but you do have to take an hour trained imam with it. And what are they going to say? No. No, they're not going to say no. And that imam will be feeding them an extremely conservative, fundamentally anti-xenophobic version of Islam. And it will be taught to their children as well. You know, the children will be going to ordinary schools, but they'll be brought along to the mosque as well, and there'll be some mini madrasa sort of operation operating there. That's happening in Muslim communities in the West. In places like Pakistan, it happens all the more. And so there's radicalization for you. Mostly it doesn't work in the West, because in fact, the mosque is not as big an influence on family life in the West as it is in a Pakistani village. There are lots of other influences too. But it is a problem, certainly, one of the things I really would do if I had the power to do it, and I do it in Canada, is not allow foreign money from state sources, and even from some donors known to be associated with state sources, to come in to build mosques, provide imams. If you did that, you would have to provide these communities with the money to do so and do it themselves from Canadian sources, but I'd be quite happy to pay that price. Mm-hmm. And of course, you can't just do this for Muslims, you're gonna have to do it more broadly as well. But I'd love to get the Saudis hands off Western education in Western Muslim societies. I say it's a good time to stop because I'm losing my voice.
Thank you, Dr. Dyer, for your lecture tonight, and thank you to all of you for your questions. I think there's a lot of confusion lately about what universities are for. Provincial governments these days seem to be asking of universities that we train students for jobs, provide them with the skills for the jobs that apparently are out there waiting for them, and also to undertake the kind of research that will result in economic innovation and more job creation. I don't think that's what universities have ever been particularly good at. Maybe what we should be doing instead is protecting jobs, shutting down our software engineering and our computer science departments. But I think universities are much better at, what we've always been better at, is the sort of thing that we've heard tonight, and that is thought-provoking analysis on the basis of long and careful observation and inquiry. So please join me in thanking. So thank you for coming.